Well, in West Marin, we're pretty lucky because it's a rural area. However, when you go out there at night and your eyes adjust, it's surprising how much ambient light you see spilling from street lights or from nearby town.
Marin's really only about 15% of it is developed in West Marin. That's a small percentage of that. And so it's one of the last bastions where wildlife actually survives. So when we have light out here, it's a way worse than if it was even over the hill in Fairfax or in a suburban area.
And it used to be that when it was the dark of the moon, I couldn't see my hand in front of my face. And I actually grew to really love that.
The constellations that I would tell the stories about, for example, are not visible or almost invisible to the naked eye anymore because of the encroaching and accelerating regional light pollution.
So what happened was I was noticing a lot of downtown light living here. So and has the one of the first things that happened was the street lights were changed to LED bulbs. It was like a glaring example of bright light versus quieter light. Other people were noticing changes too. And as we had the conversation amongst ourselves, more people were annoyed by street lights or bright lights doing light trespass into their homes. And that conversation kept growing. Inverness Park people, it's about a mile away, they were noticing some lights in Point Reyes Station and had noticed for a while lights that were bothering them but never said anything. Inverness was bothered by lights from Marshall. Marshall's bothered by lights from Inverness. So it was really interesting having these conversations with people and realizing, oh, it's not just me, or it's not just one other person. There actually is an issue here. So we decided to form a lighting committee within the Point Reyes Station Village Association, and we did an assessment of downtown lights and just looked at them and to see like what could be shielded, what would be an improved lighting example is a shielded light and a downcast light instead of a glaring light, instead of an upward facing light. Then when you read about Dark Sky International and the work they've done, you realize this is not just our community. This is all over the world, and it's increasing at a rate of 10% a year, which is a lot. So if you think about 5 years ago, living in town here, 10 years ago, you can watch and see how the light has changed, and people didn't feel it. And the last measurement taken for our town, our community, was 7%. So if we can stop it, if we can even decrease it and take it back to a level that was previous, that would be a really great thing to do.
In order to qualify for the dark sky application, we have to prove that we have measured the lighting in the area, we've reduced the lighting to conform to strict lighting standards that were established by the international illuminations engineers. And we have to provide a strong educational and outreach program. Starting about 3 years ago, we began examining the lights in town to see if any of them were what we call trespassing. The lights were of such high intensity that they glared into other people's homes, into bedrooms at night. We worked with the county to put shields on the streetlights that were shining into bedrooms. We convinced the school to put shields on their lights because they had changed the lights around 3 years ago to LED, and people could see them in their bedroom a mile away across the Tamales Bay.
One of the glaring examples, like light glares, was the fire department. They had three huge lights above their bays for the fire trucks, and they were on all night long. And we talked to them about it, and the timing was perfect because they were getting ready to do a complete remodel of the building, and that included their lighting. And so we talked to the project manager, and he had already been aware and was already thinking about dark sky lighting. So on this new remodel building next door, they removed those bright lights and well, they didn't remove them. They have them on and off only when they exit and return, and then they're off. And the lighting that's up there now is all shielded lights fixtures. They all are downward cast.
We started an education program 2 years ago where we go out onto the Giacomini wetlands and do stargazing every month when the moon is not yet up in the sky and you can see more stars. And that's been very popular, has gained us a lot of attention and a lot of support. Don has become our weatherman who keeps an eye on the clouds. And what we do is we ask people who want to come to watch our website for a week before the new moon. And the minute Don sees a night that looks like tonight's going to be a good night for stargazing, he'll post it on our website. And then whoever can come, comes, and whoever can't can hopefully come the next month.
I go to these things every month. So I've heard the same story over and over again, but I like hearing it because it's a different way of learning rather than learning with an iPhone or reading about the stars. It's this repetition of going out and sitting with 20 people in the dark. There's something very ancient and tribal about that. And the more you learn about that sky, it becomes friendly. It becomes something like familiar. And, you know, one of the things, Don talks a lot about things that are more than the stars. He talks about how stars got their names and how the Babylonians saw the stars, how the Greek myths are worked in there, how even ancient civilizations here in America named things. So it's a whole history of humanity that's there every night.
And then occasionally we'll do a public event indoors where we take one topic about lighting and its effect on wildlife or its effect on humans and talk about why it's important. As you can see, our town is right up against a national park. And now the animals don't know this is a town and that's a national park. So if they're using light to guide them for mating or for migration habits or nesting, they are fooled by the lights from the town sometimes. And so the lights we have on in town affect many species of animal that we're preserving right across the bay here.
Just about every aspect of wildlife behavior gets disrupted by artificial light at night, whether it's photoperiodism for reproduction, migratory patterns, being able to feed, being able to keep yourself away from predators, the whole gamut. It turns out that artificial light at night interrupts that. Organisms necessarily need starlight and moonlight to guide them. This interrupts that. For bats, which are very important ecologically to the community, it acts as big shields. Artificial light at night is kind of like roadways. And just like a road, they're a lot more dangerous and a lot more harmful to biodiversity the more remote the area is. And that's because there are so few areas that have wildlife left.
There are multiple causal connections with several hormonal cancers. So breast cancer, prostate cancer, lung cancer, colorectal cancer, all have direct connections with light at night. That heart disease, obesity, depression, well-being of human subjects are all now linked negatively to light at night. And that's just the human health, but the natural environment is suffering too. Various species of birds, bats, half of the insects on the planet, turtles, dung beetles use the Milky Way to navigate by, trees, all are suffering from this thing. With the preponderance of light at night and the acceleration, we are wrecking ecosystems, we're destroying ecosystems, as well as human health.
But Marin County does not have a lighting ordinance at all right now, so this will be a new thing. Initially, when we introduced the idea to the county, they said, oh, give us a sample lighting ordinance. So we did that in May of 2021. That's 2.5 years ago. We provided them a model ordinance that would conform. And then that one has not moved anywhere in the 2.5 years.
we don't have a county stance yet. That's something get worked out by an action of the Board of Supervisors. And this has not gotten to a place of being considered by the full board. So there's not really a county position on a lighting ordinance.
So I'm very supportive of Dark Sky International and the movement towards becoming a Dark Sky International community. The county on the regulatory side is still trying to understand what that means and what the county obligations are. It's just how do we get there and what's the best way for the county to do this and meet this requirement.
For the longest while, officials in the county believed that they could get away with not filing an ordinance, with just using the laws that are already embedded into our county code, and that we would still be able to go ahead with our application.
The issue the county has at this point is we don't have an enforcement mechanism to do that. And that would be part of the discussion and the ordinance. Do we need to develop that or we just use the existing enforcement tools that we have? The only time we review lighting on a building is when someone comes in for a building permit to do a change or a homeowner comes in for a remodel permit. Then we review lighting if it's a substantial remodel. So our opportunity is really small through the given processes to make these changes. So we have to figure out a way, how do we do that? So I totally get it. The community is committed to Dark Sky International designation as the goal, but in the meantime, or during that time as we're developing lighting ordinances, if we can achieve the same thing, I don't know that we actually have to have the designation to give us a dark sky.
I don't believe so, because, like I say, it's no attack on the population, but people are not fully aware of the issue, and people are not fully aware of the laws a lot of the time. And like I say, we have no enforcement, and the city, quite rightly, the cities and the local authorities have more pressing issues to deal with than going around asking people to turn the lights out. In order to fight this regional problem, we need to have regional cooperation and regional coherence. So we need to have all the planners and the local authorities neighbouring each other, talking to each other and agreeing on their ordinances. You may land an argument about the romance and the beauty and the education and the environmental side of it on some individual council members. And you may appeal to the public on those grounds. But I think the heaviest argument is it comes down to the economics. So if you can say you're going to save a huge amount of money from your lighting bill and potentially you're going to bring in tourism, the tourist dollar, by having a dark sky, the main one is going to be the economics, and then you can embellish it with the other stuff.
We've gone further, and we've done a cost analysis for changing all the bulbs. We contacted the company that provided the bulbs that are there now, and they have a dark sky friendly bulb because they've done this in many other communities across the United States. And it would cost $250 a bulb to change that. Multiplying that out, that's $34,500, I think. But that would be a cost that we'd have to figure out with the county how that would come about.
We have 130 streetlights, for example, in this area, West Marin, that will have to be addressed at some point. And we'll have to work with the owners of those streetlights, and it could be multiple owners, to just educate them about the type of lighting and light bulbs to use in those streetlights. Again, we're hoping that some of this will be just normal maintenance over time once we educate people. So the next time a bulb change out on a street light would be they'd use a bulb that's appropriate, that kind of approach through attrition. There will be some additional costs related to it. And I think that's part of what we're trying to get come to grips and understand. There's a county cost just on county buildings in the area and county facilities like fire stations and things. There's another public cost related to other infrastructure. And then there's local private costs related to commercial and homeowners. So there's like three buckets of potential costs, and they all may be funded in different ways. But what my hope is that since we have 10 years to do this, over time, once we educate people, they will actually be doing the change out, and hopefully all 130 poles, for example, will have new lighting on them in 10 years. I don't know what the turnover rate for lighting is, but I suspect light bulbs don't last longer than 5 years or so on street lights, but there'll be an opportunity to do that change out and use proper bulbs.
Just being aware of why do I need the light on? It's a big question.
There are some concerns by people who have not done the research about safety, that the more light you have, the safer you are. It's kind of like the child thinking there's a boogeyman under the bed, and if mom puts a nightlight on, they won't be afraid.
My wife and I keep our lights off at night. We don't leave lights on. There's various things that can be done, like instead of having a light on all night because someone is going to come home, you can have a motion detector that turns on for 10 or 15 seconds as you approach the porch to get you up the stairs, and then you're in the door and it goes off. The only way it would come on is animals, and we do have a lot of animals out here. There's a lot of things to be done, but I don't think it's my province. I'm aware that attention needs to be done.
I do have some outside lighting that comes on automatically for a few hours. And when I learned about the migrating, I didn't know this, that the migrating birds need the early hours of the evening when they're migrating. I just said, okay, I'm just gonna turn that off and I'll only use it if I'm leaving.
Using particular colored lights, more on the red and the orange spectrum rather than the blue spectrum, directing them away, or turning them off when they're not needed. That's the best thing, turning them off when they're not needed. And to just be aware of that. And people, you know, people out here, I'm assuming many of them are living out here because they appreciate the wildlands, because they appreciate wildlife, because they know how they connect with it some way. And so it seems to me that these would be the type of people that would do this first, that care about the world around them in a more holistic way.
Well, I think people need to know about it. I think people don't know about it. And I think one of the things for me is that it might not be that important to me unless I had gone out and really sat in the wetlands and learned about the stars. Because now that has become a part of my day. It's like before that, I was missing 12 hours of the day. That this is a whole new part of being human, to go out there. And even at 3, you know, if I wake up at 3 a.m., I can go outside and get a breath of air, and the stars are familiar to me. It's a whole, it's a little dramatic to say this, but has really changed my life to have that.